welcome to the Yolo County Library's staged reading of It Can't Happen Here.
Now, a few small things before we begin.
First, please turn off your cell phone.
And at the risk of insulting your intelligence, the state of California wants you to know that in case of an emergency, you can use the entrance nearest you as an exit. In addition, it's a 2-hour show, and we will take a 10-minute intermission about halfway through.
Next, those of you who go to the theater have undoubtedly suffered through a lot of crowd scenes. You know, where a few actors are yelling and screaming, trying to make up for the absence of a real crowd. Never works, right? So tonight, we're asking you to help us overcome that problem. All we need from you are a few simple reactions. Applause, cheers, and boos. When the time comes, when the time comes, we will be holding up these signs as signals.
But we're all in this together, right? Are you with me?
Yes.
Yes. Are you with me?
Yes.
Beautiful.
You should know that in this reading, many of the actors will be playing different characters. We have brought some hats and costume pieces to help us all keep track of who we are as we switch back and forth between roles.
Some of the roles tonight are being played by people who would have never played them in 1936.
Many of us are playing characters in their 40s, 50s, and 60s. Which we are not.
Many of us women will be playing men in the show, which we are not.
This is a staged reading, which means some moments the actors will move around the space, and often they will simply stand still.
The stage directions, which usually the audience never hears, will be read by Emily Henderson in
Woo!
The back.
Woo-hoo!
And Steve Schmidt will be playing some sounds to help create the mood.
Other than that, we will rely on your imaginations.
And finally, the management wants you to know that any resemblance of the events in the play to current events
yes,
is purely coincidental. Now, it is true, in 1936, there were race riots in our cities, a vast income gap between the rich and the poor.
A major drought in several states.
A right-wing extremist running for president.
Millions of new immigrants.
And foreign wars creating global terror.
But that's where the similarities end.
We urge you to reserve judgment before making any hasty historical parallels.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is our great pleasure to present Sinclair Lewis, It Can't Happen Here.
May 1st, 1936, a meeting of the Rotary Club in Fort Beulah, Vermont. A small platform with a podium with chairs on either side. Seated nearby is Frank Tasbro, president of the Rotary Club.
May 1st, 1936, Fort Beulah, Vermont, 6 months before the presidential election.
Excitement rippled through Town Hall, the scene of this month's meeting of the Fort Beulah Rotary Club.
For this evening's featured speaker was the great patriot and proud daughter of the American Revolution, Mrs. Adelaide Hinch.
Among the audience was Lorinda Pike, whose political views differed from every other member of the Rotary Club. With the sole exception of
Doremus Jessup, editor and proprietor of Fort Beulah's only newspaper, there to report on the passionate ejaculations of Mrs. Gimmich.
The truth, my friend, that's what we demand, the unadulterated truth. Now, this will shock you, but I want you to listen to one woman who will not waste your time with some sentimental taffy.
Yeah.
What this country needs is a real war. Industrious have to pay for the shipless ne'er-do-wells and maybe to save their lazy souls and get some iron in them, a roar might be a good thing. Senator Buzz Windrip is the only candidate who has the courage to speak the truth about
You are out of order, Mrs. Pike.
I want to register my objection.
Sit down, Lorinda.
This woman is using the election to...
Save all your bohemian friends.
She's stigmatizing the poor. Corps to create a mob.
We are all familiar with your political opinions, Mrs. Pike. But it is my duty as chairman to remind you that it is Mrs. Gooch who was invited to address us.
You're here.
Yes. 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 Sit down.
Please, take your seat. Thank you, madam. I'm so sorry, Mrs. Gooch. You were saying?
Thank you, Mr. Tansborough. And to all you who believe in freedom of speech, let me leave you now with some very good news. At this moment, Minutemen marching clubs made up of volunteers are springing up across the country. Young Christians learning warlike skills that may help to rid our country with its undesirable elements. A new generation of American patriots armed with the sword and the gospel, ready to reclaim the future and lead our nation toward its God-given destiny.
So what did you think of Mrs. Gimmich, Remus?
I confess, Archie, that I will never understand the dogmas of the American Revolution. They spend half their time boasting of being descended from the revolution fighters of 1776. And the other more ardent half, they're attacking anyone who believes in precisely the principles for which those ancestors struggled.
So you learn nothing from her talk?
Oh, no, on the contrary, Frank. For her defense of freedom of speech gave me a whole new understanding of the word ironic.
Why don't you take a tumble to yourself, Doritos? All those years at the Daily Informer? You've had a lot of fun, haven't you, posing as the liberal voice of Beulah Valley?
I hadn't realized that I was posing.
You're out of touch with your readers.
These are serious times, Jessup. The next election will be critical for the future of our country. With Buzz Windrip running for president, we finally have a real choice.
Well, I'd rather think Mr. Windrip should be on the vaudeville circuit than stumping for the nomination.
How long have we known each other, Remus? 50 years? Have you ever seen discontent like this before? Senator Windrip's got a good feel for people and a great head for business. I assure you, he's an excellent chance taking the Democratic nomination away from Roosevelt.
And if Bishop Crane is League of Forgotten Men throw in with him, he'll win. And win by considerable margin.
Cry havoc and let slip the dogs of war.
You can quote scripture to us all you want, Mrs. Pike. It won't change the outcome.
I don't think that's Shakespeare, Frank. My God.
You think this is a joke?
You'll forgive me, gentlemen, if I don't believe that Mr. Windrip's campaign has any legitimacy. I think Mrs. Pike and I still have some semblance of faith in the American electorate.
Speak for yourself.
Roosevelt is through. The economy's in tatters.
The New Deal is no deal.
So.
You're all missing the point. People will vote for Windrip to make themselves feel safe, but they're ignoring what he's actually saying. If he gets into office, he's going to unleash a reign of terror.
Reign of what?
And you, the liberal editor, and you, the staunch industrialist, and you, the conservative banker, will be led straight to the firing
squad. Are you mad, Mrs. Pike?
This is America, for God's sakes. It would never happen.
You remember how Huey Long became monarch of Louisiana? Windrip is using the same political strategy, pit everybody against somebody, then seize the reins of power. Have you read his book, The Zero Hour? He's demanding that the president have a freer hand and not be tied down by a bunch of dumb, shyster lawyer congressmen. His words, gentlemen, not mine. You watch. If he manages to broker this alliance with Bishop Prang, it will obliterate the line between church and state and create the perfect conditions for fascism. You think? It can't happen in America, let me tell you. It can.
Are you done?
If Buzz Windrip gets elected, we'll all be done.
Lorinda exits.
I think we can officially classify Widow Pike as a hysteric.
That woman needs to remarry as soon as humanly possible.
The way she shoots off her fat mouth, you'd think she was the mayor instead of the owner of the saloon.
It is not some cheap saloon, gentlemen, and Mrs. Pike is not a crank who needs to be locked up or shut up.
Time to quit playing tag with Lorinda and your pinko friends, Remus. Stop giving lip service to all those subversive elements. You know how many Jew financiers I got telling me how to run my own textile mill?
The bag is practically ripe with the stench of communists.
The only stench that I can smell right now is coming from you two. This political climate is clearly doing wonders for your sense of depravity.
Fine, you sit up there on your editorial throne and pontificate about the state of democracy while the blood of the country is being sucked out by radicals and spooks.
That is a statement born of either stupidity or hatred, Archie. And I would have hoped that both of those were right beneath you.
You want to be on the right side of this come November, Doreen.
A blind mule has a greater chance of being elected president than Buzz Windrip.
You're underestimating him.
Nay, you're underestimating the country.
That would be overestimating, Frank. And no, I don't think I am.
You will.
The White House is there for the taking. As it turns out, there are no blind mules running for president this year.
It's a new day in America, Remus.
Crowley and Tasborough exit. Doremus slightly slumps, sighs, makes his way home. Act 1, Scene 3.
Doremus went to his home, a white clapboard square structure of the vintage 1880, which he declared to be ugly,
but ugly in a nice way.
He found refuge in his study,
which he forbade under any circumstance to be claimed,
and which was filled with an endearing mess of novels.
Copies of the Congressional Record,
the New Yorker,
Time,
the New Republic,
new masses,
treatises on taxation,
roadmaps,
volumes on exploration in Abyssinia and the Antarctic,
fishing tackle,
two comfortable old leather armchairs,
Bible,
the Quran,
the Book of Mormon,
a shotgun,
selections from Mahabharata,
a vase from Crete dating from 327 BC, very ugly,
odd pairs of spectacles that no longer suited his eyes,
the complete works of Thomas Jefferson,
a shaky portable typewriter,
a canary in a Bavarian gilded wicker cage,
seven books on Bolshevism, extraordinarily pro and extraordinarily con,
another copy of the complete works of Thomas Jefferson,
a worn, linen-bound copy of Old Hearthside Songs for Home and Picnic,
and an old cast-iron Franklin stove.
He allowed no one in.
Not even his family.
Not his wife, Emma.
Not as old as Philip.
Not his youngest, Sissy.
Not his middle child, Mary.
Her husband, Fowler.
Nor his 8-year-old grandson, David.
Only did he let in Foolish, the family dog, whose bark awakened the canary under the absurd old blue sweater that covered its cage.
What can I do, huh, Foolish? Write another editorial about growing alarm?
But the presence of Foolish comforted Doremus, made belching politicians seem unimportant, and in the security of his study, he fell asleep in his soft brown leather chair.
He falls asleep. Act 1, Scene 4, July 4th, 1936. Doremus wakes up slowly.
A bow, bow, bow!
See him not in the house!
A bow, bow! Bow, 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 bow!
Don't shoot!
They went that way.
Bow, 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 bow!
Doremus!
Dad, it's time to go.
Doremus, the car's already packed!
Oh, I can't go on any blame picnic. I have to stay home. I've got to listen to Prime's broadcast. I'll see you in the car.
10 minutes, everybody. Hey, Pop, have you seen my little soldier?
Oh, he was just shooting up the place.
No, I hope you weren't in the line of fire.
Oh, hey, you're the doctor. If I get wounded, you can treat me.
It's the 4th of July, Dad. We're going on a family picnic.
Well, when did you get to be your mother's daughter?
Just this morning. Come on, Buck's coming as well.
He's even threatening to bring a baby. Well, we have to be back in time.
You'll be back in time for the broadcast.
Bow, bow!
The battle continues.
Transition. A blue sky, a green hill. Doremus stands watching as Sissy runs on stage carrying a picnic basket. Julia runs on in pursuit of her. They head off stage. Doremus takes in the bucolic scene, breathing the fresh air, as various members of his family cross the hillside. Some carry food, some blankets, some games. Some circle toward an area on the side where the picnic is set up, but others go off by themselves, strolling and talking.
Philip!
Morning, Peter.
Since when do lawyers not work on holidays?
Huh? Look who's talking.
So where's the family?
Marilla took the kids to Boston to see her folks.
Ah, the favorite grandparents, I see.
It was their turn, Dad. Family roulette. You know how it is.
It's hard having family so far away. We're lucky he could come at all.
A sweater.
In case you're cold. Perfectly fine, my dear.
You don't know yourself,
Dormouse.
Trust me on this score. David! Careful with that sparkler!
Enter Mary and Fowler trailing.
David, you're going to burn someone's eyes.
It's only a sparkler, honey. He'll be fine.
My mother is worried.
Your mother's not worried.
I'm worried!
It's part of his American birthright, Mary. A boy gets to set off a few fireworks on Independence Day.
Oh, he grabs her around the waist and kisses her. He smiles at her as Sissy and Julian walk on again.
You've got to listen up, Julian. I didn't say I was going to go for a drive.
That's not what it sounded like.
Though he does have an awfully nice DeSoto.
See, how can I compete with a brand new DeSoto?
They run off as Emma and Philip enter. They head to the picnic area as Buck Titus comes on.
There he is, my favorite bachelor. I thought you were bringing a date, Buck.
Oh, I can't bring a date. Every time I do, you start making wedding plans.
Should we do the balloons, Mother?
Let's lay out the blanket first. Doremus, did we remember to call Lorinda?
I did, Mom.
But who joins Doremus?
Will you look at that view?
So the view. Why do people so obsessed with the view?
Oh, come on, Buck. Look at that. Never seen anything more beautiful. The way that the hills envelop the lake and the sky floats like a blue canopy on that water. It's as if God decided to make Fort Buell of Vermont his personal showcase.
Spoken like a man who spends all his time indoors.
Are farmers supposed to be in awe of the splendors of nature?
You need to spend a few weeks on your knees pulling weeds, my friend.
Lorinda enters and joins them.
Look at that view! A woman after my own heart.
God help me, I'm outnumbered.
I'm just re-educating Buck here on the wonders of nature.
You love playing the romantic, don't you, Doremus?
Sissy runs on, laughing breathless, chased by Julian.
Hi, Miss Libby.
Hi, Buck.
Mom, is there anything to drink yet?
Give me a minute.
They run off. Lorinda hands Emma a cake.
German bun cake.
Oh, you know me so well. Oh, will you look at that view?
Emma exits with the cake.
And to think this perfect day will culminate in Buzz Winder being endorsed by Bishop Peter Prang.
You mean Prophet Peter Prang.
And his League of Forgotten Crazy Men.
When did religious fanatics become the brokers of our political life?
While we were taking in the view,
Prang will never endorse him.
Who else would he endorse?
I agree with Remus. Prang keeps his leverage by not endorsing anyone.
Besides, Winder's too much of a loose cannon for someone like Prang.
Our man Buzz thinks he can get away with saying anything.
It's working pretty well for him so far.
I've got to catch up with him. He seems hell-bent on offending everyone.
Including the press.
Especially the press.
But he loves the publicity. He's got you right where he wants you, Doremus. The more offensive his remarks, the more papers get sold.
Oh, maybe I should quit while I'm ahead. Sell the Informer. Move to Tahiti.
You die of boredom within 2 weeks.
How to find the right company.
Oh, pow, pow, pow!
Not too far, son.
That looks like the cavalry's outrun the artillery.
I can't keep up.
Where's David?
He's heading to the light brigade down the hill.
Fowler, he can't go down your mine, son.
I'll get him.
No, Buck, it's too much.
That's no trouble, Mary, really. We'll watch the parade from up close. Come on, let's take down the hill, General. You take the left flank, I'll take the right.
Buck goes after David.
Buck will never survive by himself. Wait up!
Come on, he's fine. Let's take a walk. They leave as another man, the unkempt, rough-edged Shad Ladue, carries in a massive glass cistern of iced tea.
Have you turned the ice cream yet, Shad?
If I had turned it before I made the tea, it would have melted by the time I got here. You people ever think about getting an electric freezer? Or is me having a broken back not matter? Let me know.
Shad puts down his load and storms off. Philip goes to Doremus.
Why do you keep that fellow on?
Oh, Shad's been with us for so long. I've almost grown fond of him.
Happy now.
I tell myself I'm doing a social experiment. Trying to train him to be as gracious as the average Neanderthal man.
Hey, you raised me. Neanderthal's all your specialty.
Honestly, I feel bad for him. I'm not even sure he can read.
I'm surprised you didn't take it upon yourself to teach him.
You told me he greatly admired Buzz Windrip. Can you believe it?
Philip is about to answer, but suddenly Emma declares,
"Look at that view!" It is beautiful, my dear.
They watch the fireworks.
Truly beautiful.
They're about to start the fireworks. Come on, everybody, gather around.
Sissy and Julian, Mary and Fowler, Doremus and Emma gather to take in the view as we hear the sound of fireworks.
Happy Fourth, Remus. Happy Fourth, everybody.
Act 1, Scene 5. Lights change. Static is heard. The scene energetically shifts to the family parlor. There may be set pieces, there may be not, but one thing there must be is a large, old-fashioned radio, the kind that stands as high as 4 feet off the floor. Doremus adjusts the radio amidst the static, trying to dial in a station. Finally, Doremus gets a clear signal.
These little ditties are brought to you by Toily Oily, the natural home guitar, and performed for your listening pleasure by The Smoothies, a trio who makes America proud. Now here they are again, The Smoothies.
Smoothies? God, who listens to this?
You're on the wrong station, Dad. Here, let me get it for you.
A man's voice is heard on the radio.
This is Bishop Peter Prang speaking to you, my friends of the radio audience, with an announcement pertaining to the upcoming presidential election, an election that will determine the fate of this distraught nation. A single question now hovers over us, whether to endorse any of the candidates who seek the nomination for president.
For many months now, I and the League of the Forgotten have prayed to the Lord, like
Joseph in the desert.
Is David still asleep?
Yes, thank God. Please, everybody,
our faith has been sorely
yelling.
Tested. There are no easy answers to this complicated question,
As you know, we have not been inclined to endorse any candidates.
See? He's not.
Our prayers have been directed to ensuring that both the control of credit and the power to issue money be taken away from the banks.
Sounds like the communist manifesto.
And that all inheritances be drastically cut, and all swollen incomes be severely limited.
These people have ideology.
But Satan is powerful. The League of Forgotten Men must make a stand to fight against all subversive organizations, which unfortunately are so largely Jewish, and which must be driven with whips and scorpions off the face of the earth. And so it is that after months of prayer, the directors of the League of Forgotten Men and I myself announce that in the coming Democratic National Convention, we shall, without any reservation, use our strength to secure the Democratic presidential nomination for Senator Berzelius Windrip and elect him as president of these United States. May God bless Senator Windrip, and may God bless us all.
God help us all.
I cannot believe it.
You told us.
What did she tell you?
I told them that praying would endorse Windrip, but they didn't believe
me. It surprises me,
too.
It surprises me, Father.
Oh, mark my words, the Prank's evangelicals will never stay loyal to Windrip.
It may be time for Roosevelt to form a third party.
Which would allow Windrip to win without a majority.
The price of democracy.
Sometimes I'm tempted to turn communist.
You've read one book, Julie.
Fine idea. Out of the frying pan of Windrip and Hitler, into the fire of Uncle Joe Stalin.
Perhaps we should hold off before rushing to judgment?
Philip, the man's a racist and a woman hater.
Yes, Lorinda. He said some terrible and inflammatory things. But why do you think he has so many people to support him?
Well, their collective IQ is probably lower than that of the average.
Is it not because they're all stupid and prejudiced and blind? The League of Forgotten Men is aptly named. People want a voice. They want agency over their lives.
Are you supporting Buzz Windrip?
Absolutely not. But if we don't like him, we better figure out the reasons behind his popularity.
There may be a minority of people.
Maybe? Listen to yourself, Dad. Your liberal self-righteousness is giving you away.
Self-righteousness?
Philip, you shouldn't speak to your father that way.
He never listens to what I have to say.
Self-righteous.
Mom,
where are you? Oh, we're 10 minutes of
peace. I have got it.
Mom,
relax, Mary. Young communists and I will read in the bedtime story.
Sissy leaves and pulls Julian with her. Mary strides off.
Don't make me institute Robert's rules of order in this house. Just listen to him, Doremus. That's all he wants. Buck, Lorinda, would you join me in the kitchen?
Emma exits with Buck and Lorinda.
What I was trying to say, Dad, is that even if it's a minority that's supporting Senator Windrip, you're marginalizing
it's
the problem.
It's about money.
Okay, sure. Yes. And identity. And trust. As in, who can people trust to fight for?
Even when that trust comes at the expense of the truth.
The truth for you may not be the same truth for the average man.
Doremus looks at Philip. Shad enters with a load of firewood.
Ah, perfect. Shad, I'd like to ask you a question.
About what?
How are you planning to vote?
I've told you before.
Humor me, please.
Like I said, I'm voting for Windrip.
And why is that?
He's willing to fight for things, for the working man.
Yeah, you see?
He's going to fix it so everybody can give $5,000 immediately.
Exactly. It's about the money.
Yeah, I figure I can start a chicken farm.
Oh, chickens! Didn't all our chickens die on the watch last year?
Well, with that kind of money, I can buy a couple thousand, beat the odds this time.
And so you believe Senator Windrip will fulfill this promise of giving away this money?
It's a monetary incentive.
I already started buying equipment on credit.
On credit? The bank gave you credits on Windrip's campaign promise.
Good enough for them.
Oh, really? $5,000 credit to buy chickens?
People make 10 times that on a good farm. I wouldn't sell low on chickens if I was you, Mr. Jessup. I've been reading up on it.
Is that so?
Smarter than they look.
Chad picks up his axe and walks out.
There you have it, Dad. The average man incentivized to better himself.
That's your analysis. This is immoral, Philip. Windrip is literally buying the election.
It's an expedient political promise made by anyone who's ever run for office.
$5,000 in cash.
And Roosevelt promised to balance the budget, and before him, Hoover promised a chicken in every pot. They all lied, all of them. There's not a single politician in this country that can tell the truth and get elected.
Well, first you say that Windrip is motivating people with creative business practices, and then you say he's lying through his teeth? Well, which is it?
It could be both. I have no idea.
Ah, that's the first sensible thing you have said.
It's a flaw in our system, Dad.
Professional politicians have to rally the troops by whatever means necessary. But hey, maybe Winthrop will do some good and we should all invest in Chad's little enterprise. Who knows? Your Neanderthal man might make a go of it. Take care, Dad.
Philip leaves. As he does, he passes Lorinda, who is entering.
What happened? You were right.
Act 2, Scene 1. The streets of Fort Beulah, Vermont.
By October, Winthrop had secured the Democratic nomination and FDR had indeed formed the third party. Doremus found himself traveling up and down Beulah Valley, getting interviews, trying to find out the secret to Buzz's growing popularity.
You want to know why I support Buzz?
The man is funny.
He makes me laugh so hard.
He's given every citizen $5,000.
I got 5,000 reasons for you.
I got debts.
I got kids.
I hear it's $10,000.
What's the point of college if you can't get a decent job?
Our relief check goes away in 61 days.
You know what a mortgage is, mister.
He makes me laugh.
Me too.
I'm telling you, funny.
What a character.
You want to talk about lack of character? Let's talk FDR.
Never did like FDR.
Roosevelt? I heard he changed her for Rosenvelt.
Yeah.
That man doesn't know when to quit.
Look at FDR, starting a third party.
You want to talk about a demagogue.
What's the alternative? Trowbridge?
Trowbridge? The best the Republicans could come up with is Walter Trowbridge.
Oh, I mean, you gotta be kidding me. The man's an embarrassment to Mildred.
I listen to Trowbridge when I want to fall asleep.
Roosevelt and Trowbridge, professional liars, the both of them.
Buzz tells it like it is. You have to respect that.
I'm not saying I agree with all his methods.
It's time to clean up the garbage.
Maybe it's what we need right now.
I honestly don't care how he does it.
It's the 0 hour, folks. Time to pay the piper.
He was telling this story the other day. You know, like a regular old story. Like a regular guy telling a regular old story.
Did you hear the one about how he pretended he was his own publicity man? He phones this big shot journalist.
Yeah, he says to this guy, "Hey Al, I got an exclusive for you on BuzzFeed."
I mean, him all this stuff about himself.
Buzz is the greatest, he tells him. Buzz is the best. Buzz is the smartest man in the world.
And the journalist, he buys it. What's the whole thing?
Brass balls on that guy.
He's gotta be president.
USA! 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 USA!
You.
It was astonishing. It was utterly astonishing. Every one of them. They seemed entranced by him. And when I told them that he schooled the Senate on how to catch a catfish while drinking huge amounts of corn whiskey, and then he performed a hornpipe jig in front of the faculty of Yale, their admiration for him only increased.
Is that story true about impersonating his own publicity man?
That's the thing. It doesn't matter if it's true.
But what about Congress? Where are they in all this?
Congress is in chaos. It makes no difference to them if they all hate it. Half of them don't want to be left behind in case he wins. And the other half are trying to figure out which rock to climb under.
Can't the party take the nomination away from him?
They don't have the guts.
You honestly think he'll be elected?
Julian. 6 months ago, I would have said that there was no way on God's green earth that this fellow could have been elected. And now, I have no idea.
Well, it sure sounds like he knows how to put on a show. It's a hornpipe jig anyway.
I don't know, but I kind of like to see him do one.
You know where she is at, Mr. Jensen? I have not, Julian, but you know, there's no time like the present.
Emma!
You know, I've got to go to New York. After I get to New York, it's time to look that blind mule in the eye.
Act 2, Scene 2, November 1, 2 days before the presidential election. The final campaign rally for Buzz Winthrop. The energy is electric. Bunting is unfurled. Nets filled with bags of confetti hang from the rafters, ready to be released. Drummers pound away a rocking rhythm, while a couple of audience wranglers induce the house into rhythmic clapping. 4 Minutemen march in and stand facing out at the lip of the stage as stagehands wheel on a very tall platform where Buzz Winthrop will appear. Before Buzz appears, however, we have the separate entrances of two people. First, an ancient Civil War vet, Private William Dooley, wearing a Confederate jacket adorned with medals and waving a small American flag. Second, Bishop Peter Prang, a clergyman and leader of the League of Forgotten Men. The two men wave to the crowd. They disperse.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the next president of the United States of America, Berzelius Buzz Winthrop!
Abbott Dooley, who proudly served our country in the Civil War and went to Washington the other night. Yes, yes. Thanks to our volunteer Minutemen. And of course, my friend, my spiritual advisor, Bishop Peter Prang. There's also a few people out in the house that I want to especially acknowledge, Betty and Jack Schaefer up there in the lodge. You guys have done so much for my campaign. I love you guys. That Betty can make some mean barbecue too. Right? Right? And Roger Strauch. Is Roger here? Roger, this man. A great patriot and a great businessman. Roger has a great nose like myself to smell deals that other people can't smell, right? It's an art. It's an art, isn't it, Roger? It makes me proud to call you my friend. My friend. Yes. And so here we are, all of us, gathered here on this, dare I say, holy night, only 2 days away from the election, poised for victory. Hard-fought, free-swinging campaign. I mean, think of the odds, folks. Think about how we got here. I've had more nasty things said about me than anyone who has ever run for office. Can you believe some of these so-called journalists? Have you ever seen such a pack of more lying, disgusting people? They say I want money. Like, money? I've turned down offers from law firms right here in New York for 3 times the amount of money I'll get as president. They say I want power. Yes. It's true. It's absolutely true. I do want power, but great, big, imperial power. But not for me. I want it for you. The power to smash our enemies.
That's right.
Put God back in the classroom. Yeah. Our Second Amendment.
Yeah.
To support our boys in uniform. To make every single politician work for you. And the power, my friends, to win. Yeah. Let me tell you something, folks, right now, we're not winning. We got a whole lot of crooked and lazy and conniving.
Stop with Waitress! Stop! This man is a liar and a hate mother! People should be getting wrapped up! Oh,
you're right! See, in the good old days, we didn't know what to do at that point. See that? We're bringing back the good old days, folks. See, I love that guy. No, I really do. And you know why? Because he's angry. Now, sure, he's got it all wrong, and he's been brainwashed by all the wrong people, but think about it.
Yeah.
That anger is the same anger that has fueled our revolution and is at the heart of the discontent that is spread across this
country. That's right.
But what makes us different is we are harvesting our anger. Right? We are cultivating it for a higher purpose.
Right.
We are growing it into something fierce and beautiful, a force of nature that is strong enough to beat back our enemies and protect our loved ones.
Yes.
And that can defend our liberty and create a safe home, a safe harbor, a safe haven for every single person living in the United States. In the last 6 months, I have crisscrossed this great nation of ours, New York to California, Texas to Ohio, Florida, Iowa, Maine, you name it. And everywhere I go, I hear the same thing. Buzz, you gotta fight the good fight. Buzz, you gotta fight the good fight. So that's my pledge to you tonight. We are not gonna stop talking and walking till we get to the promised land. Now people ask if I'm afraid to say, no.
No.
I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid, I tell them. Because the greatest people in the world are with me. Are you with me?
Yes!
No, I said, are you with me?
Yes!
Yeah. We will illuminate the night, and we will march straight into the blessed white light.
Yeah!
Thank you all, and God bless us.
Is coming down and the echoes of the song recedes, Doremus enters and stands alone on the stage. It's the next day. Doremus looks around, looks up, silence. He takes out a small notebook and begins to write some notes. Several workmen with brooms begin to sweep off the stage. We are in an auto repair shop. One of the men is Carl Pascal, the local communist, a small, intensely passionate man. He knows Jessup and respects him. He whistles while he sweeps.
Still here, Mr. Jessup? Car's not going to be ready till tomorrow.
Sorry, Pascal, my mind is elsewhere.
You writing an article? We heard you were in New York for Winthrop's speech last night. I keep trying to remember what exactly happened.
I was there. No more than 50 feet away, and I listened to every word the man said. And I can't remember a single one. I just remember being swept up by this force.
And the buzzer put a spell on you, huh?
I started thinking that maybe he's not such a bad fella after all. Maybe the act is just that. It's an act. And then maybe it's all going to be fine. And then I started feeling sick, that I was feeling good about something that was making me sick.
Janie Johnson, a young worker, comes in with a mop and a bucket. She and Pascal nod to each other. Pascal starts whistling again, which jars Doremus out of his own thoughts.
You know, for someone who claims to he hates Winthrop, you don't seem very distressed, Carl.
You need to brush up on your revolutionary theory, Mr. Jessup. The Winthrop campaign is bringing the class struggle front and center. The system's on the verge of collapsing, whether he gets elected or not. You watch, all hell's about to break loose.
And this is a source of happiness for the communists?
Mr. Marx couldn't have written it up any better. We're going to have to give Winthrop a medal for waking everybody up.
So, let me ask you, Pascal, tomorrow, who will you be voting for?
Yeah, I'll vote.
But why are you voting if you don't think it matters who wins? Excuse me, sir, you're always going on about how the election's just a sideshow.
Correct. It's an empty bourgeois ritual. What's the percentage of people who even voted in the last presidential election?
I have no idea.
Just over half.
You see? The system's broken, Johnson. You know it, and I know it. Hell, Mr. Jessup here knows it.
The system is fractured, certainly, but this country is not ready for a revolution.
People are never ready for revolution. Look at Johnson.
Look at me, what?
You prepared to fight? To take to the streets? No, you're not. But trust me, if you had to, you would.
But the goal is civil discourse, not civil war. What we need is patience.
No offense, Mr. Chesson, but patience is something that only petite bourgeois liberals can afford. We got 1% of the country owning 42% of the wealth. 42%. The sidewalks in every city in this country are crammed with homeless people. People are dying, Mr. Jessup, every minute of every day. So you go talk to them about patience and civility and the higher ideals of American democracy. You know what answers they got for you right now? Give me food or give me Buzz Winthrop. The only solution is revolution.
John Polakoff enters, an expansive big personality, an old friend of Jessup and sparring partner with Pascal.
Is that a bullhorn I hear before me? Evening, Mr. Jessup. Is Karl Marx Pascal here bending your ears, Beth? You want to be careful with King Karl here. He's one crazy sectarian dog. Believes in violence instead of the evolutionary process of building socialism.
It's not about believing in violence. How many times have we been over
this? Karl and his comrades had just joined me and Norman Thomas and the other intelligent socialists in the United Front with Roosevelt. We wouldn't be here wondering if the buzzard is going to be our next president.
Windrip's not the point, John, and you know it.
First, you guys don't endorse FDR for the nomination, so he's got to go the third party route. And now, when it's down to the wire in a tight race, you and your comrades, the Communist Party, are siphoning off votes with your own damn candidate. Earl Browder? Seriously?
Browder's the only revolutionary on the slate, the only one representing the interests of the working class.
So what? Buzz Winthrop, the biggest fascist threat this country has ever seen, may become president because you're going to vote for Earl Browder?
It's too easy to blame everything on Winthrop, John. Why don't you read Marx instead of always gassing about it? Winthrop's just something nasty that we vomited up. It's the sickness that made us throw him up that we've got to attend to.
You and your comrades are handing in the election.
If it hadn't been Winthrop, it would have been somebody else. This ain't about a single lunatic or a single election in a so-called democracy. It's about a system that creates a permanent underclass, a global underclass that's gonna keep on growing until the whole thing goes bust.
And do you really think that Karl Marx had the dope on this?
Of course I do.
The Marxist-Leninists are always right, Johnson. Who cares if it's a close election? Who cares that the Supreme Court will be overrun by fascists?
Forget the election, John. We're in a revolutionary moment.
We're not building a vanguard party. We're building a mass movement. And mass action can only be achieved through a united front. United. As in uniting a majority of people. Until people like Mr. Jessup here can be convinced to join us, we can't have a party that will accomplish anything. Am I right, Mr. Jessup?
I am afraid I disagree.
With who?
Everyone. I prefer mass action by one person.
Mass action by one person? How does that work?
It means that change cannot be implemented by any party or state, because everything that is worthwhile in the world has been accomplished by the single, free, inquiring spirit.
Well, you and Henry David Thoreau better figure out that we're all sharing the same bathtub. Because John's right about one thing. We're going to need everybody we can get for the next go-round.
We got to be going, Mr. Jessup. Big union meeting today. You want to come? Bound to be some fur flying about tomorrow's election. Might be good for whatever you're writing.
Mind if I stay for a few minutes? I just need to jot down a couple things.
Look after Mr. Jessup, will you, Johnson? We'll save a seat for you at the meeting. And you, sir, don't forget to vote. Carl?
They start to walk off. Pascal one way, Polakoff and Johnson another.
Where are you going? Door's over here.
We can go out this way.
It's locked.
Then unlock it. It's a lot shorter than walking all the way around.
I'm not unlocking anything. Will you come on?
Right, all right.
My God, always with the shortcuts.
I'm telling you, it's quicker to go the other way.
You'd argue with your own dead grandmother.
My grandmother's dead.
That's probably why.
And they're gone.
So, what do you think, Mr. Justice, about what? Are you ready for a revolution?
Act 3, Scene 1. Doremus stands on stage while others speak the following narration. Hail to the Chief, plays quietly underneath.
On November 3rd, 1936, Mr. Berzelius Winter was elected the 33rd President of the United States.
Oh my God, what have we done?
He wasted no time, quite literally, by giving the shortest inauguration speech in history.
My fellow Americans, as President of the United States of America, I want to inform you that the new Real Deal has started right this minute, and we're all going to enjoy the manifold liberties to which our country entitles us, and have a whale of a good time doing it, I thank you.
All were invited to the inaugural festivities.
Including Mr. Roosevelt.
Who, unfortunately, had to beg off, claiming he was deathly ill.
Although that same day he was seen in a New York shop buying books on gardening and looking abnormally cheerful.
President Winthrop chose the age-old custom of giving his political adversaries diplomatic posts in countries as far away as possible.
Herbert Hoover was given Brazil.
And Mr. Roosevelt, Liberia.
Which he declined.
Mrs. Adelaide Targimich, after her spirited campaign for Mr. Winthrop, was publicly angry that she was offered a position no higher than a post in the customs office in Nome, Alaska.
I demand that there immediately be created the cabinet position of Secretariat of Domestic Science, Child Welfare, and Anti-Vice.
Her demand being denied, she threatened to turn Republican or Communistic, but in April she was heard of in Hollywood writing the scenario of a giant motion picture to be called
The Revolt of the Beavers, a Love Story.
This is truly absurd.
The celebratory mood was suddenly cut short when President Winthrop discovered, to the surprise of many,
but not to those in the know, that
Mexico, Europe, and Russia are colluding to plot our downfall. And for this reason, I am placing the entire country on high alert.
Emma!
Oh, my God.
What is it now?
You heard?
He is creating a police state.
Oh, you worry too much. I have to run some errands. It'll work out.
In addition, I am, by executive order, authorizing the Minutemen to serve as an armed militia. These brave men and women, now numbering 500,000 strong, will keep our borders safe and stand at the ready to attack our enemies.
Doremus Jessup felt himself getting smaller.
Felt himself drifting for what seemed like days on end.
Until he found himself standing in the nave of a church.
I'd give anything for a sermon that would restore my faith in humanity.
But instead he found...
Now amidst our changing times, what so many of us fail to realize is how we sin. How any sin that we ourselves may commit reflects not only on ourselves, but those that we...
So he looked for solace elsewhere.
Doremus enters Lorinda's tavern, shivering and shaking the sleet off of his jacket.
On a sleety night in the middle of the winter, Doremus drove through the streets of Fort Beulah, the wind howling with a velocity that felt diabolical. Now at last, he arrived at his destination, and there he found Lorinda Pike.
closing up the Beulah Valley Tavern.
It's evil out there.
Are we talking about Windrip or the weather?
There's this unconfirmed report of over 100 congressmen being charged with inciting to riot.
That's rich. Accusing others of being thugs? Yesterday I saw a gang of Minutemen beating up a protester in front of City Hall. He was just a kid with a sign.
I hear here Drugbridge may have fled to Canada. If I try to get a source to confirm any of that, then I have a feeling they're going to arrest me too. If I didn't hate Canadian ale so much, I'd have out of mind to grab the family and sneak off myself. I'd take you too,
of course.
Would you now?
I'd have to. I'd go on without you.
We'll all go on one way or another, but someone has to stay and fight.
Oh, I'm too old to go to jail, Tim. You know, I went to church this morning, Paul Franks, the parish where my father preached. I was looking for...
What?
I don't know.
How's your family holding up?
Well, Philip has virtually disappeared. His practice is booming, but he's become impossible to reach.
Price of success?
I suppose so. It's also strange. Mary and Fowler, they're consumed with the day-to-day, and Sissy's spinning out of control. Emma. Oh, Emma. She just listens to the radio and says, how dreadful, and then goes off to worry about how the saucepan got burnt.
Home sweet home.
Let's get out of here. I spent my entire time in church just calculating how many days I've got left in my life. What are we doing, Lorinda? None of this makes any sense. Hey, why don't we just get up? Why don't we get out of here?
Where would we go?
Oh, I don't know. Anywhere, Tahiti.
What are you pretending after, Remus? If you're looking for God or your father or...
I'm not looking at anything except for you. That's the biggest lie you've ever told me.
No, I'm not lying to you.
Then you're lying to yourself.
Do you ever stop to think how curious it is that neither of us feels guilty or embarrassed, and yet we're reasonable people? There's nothing reasonable about us.
They go to kiss, but are interrupted by the headlights of a car. Remus notices something out the window.
What is it? There's a fellow that's been watching this place. Do you see him?
Standing behind that big bush across the road.
I suspect it's my hired man.
Shad?
Yeah, he's been lurking in all kinds of places. A little black man.
Sissy enters, drunk.
Good evening, Father.
Oh.
Whoa, hey there, Miss Lindy.
Are you drunk?
That's insane.
Of course. We need to be going.
It's cold outside.
Sissy.
I saw your car outside and I thought, well, what's Dad doing at Lindy's so late?
We were talking about politics.
Politics.
Yeah, it's time to go home. Good night.
Bye, Miss Lindy.
Good night.
So, Dad, do you go to Lindy's often?
No, not especially.
But, like, every day, right?
Get in the car. Hey, shouldn't you be home, Chad? Furnace needs tending.
Who are you yelling at?
No one.
Okay.
He starts the car. They drive.
Father, you and Lindy... You're these wild-eyed performers. You belong together.
What?
Why don't you and her, you know, kind of be lovers?
That's enough, Cecilia.
What are you scared of? It's not like you and Mom have shared a bed in the last 10 years.
That is none of your business.
I live in the same house, you know. I see what's going on, or what's not going on.
This conversation is over.
We talk about everything under the sun, so I don't see why we can't
talk. We are not discussing
this. Watch out!
Sorry.
Dizzy.
Sorry, Listen, Sissy. You just can't be flip about those sort of serious things.
I hate to break it to you, Dad, but you've got all these ideas of freedom in your head that never make it below your neckline. And if you're gonna fight Windrip and his League of God-forsakers, you gotta get some life back into you. Take off the lace mitts and put on the brass knuckles. Instead of being all wretched all the time.
Oh, I'm not wretched.
You're worse than wretched. You're a sold salad cuss.
Be serious.
I am being serious. The world's gone upside down. Crazy. Everything that seems wrong and everything seems right and everything that's right seems wrong. And everything that's wrong seems right. And there are men with guns on every street corner, and it's wacky scary. But what scares me more is you. the man whose idea of a good bedtime story was Thomas Jefferson. And I liked it, Dad. Heck, you're the one who taught me, if you want to know who you are, then don't ask, act. So do it. Act. Do something. Anything to stop this moping around like a dog who's lost his bone. Sorry, Dad. Thanks, young ladies. They're out these days.
Doremus brings the car to a stop.
Sissy. Listen, about your mother.
Don't worry about Mom. She's stumbling.
Sissy starts to head in as Shad pulls up on the bike.
Evening, Mrs.
Why, where'd you come from?
Get in the house and tell your mother I'll be right in.
I didn't mean to frighten you. You have a good night.
What do you think you're doing?
Just coming from work.
Work? Really? You were supposed to be here.
I go wherever you go, Chief.
So you admit you were spying on me.
And old Mrs. Pike. A lot of honey in that body.
You're fired.
Funny. I was going to tell you the same thing.
You were going to fire me?
I would have left you a note, seeing as you probably didn't think I could write or read. I thought it'd be a waste of time. So I skipped it. But if I had written it, it would have said that I had
found it. Oh, Minuteman. I see. Well, good luck working for free.
Change in policy, Chief. They're paying now. Not much, just twice what you had. And look what they gave me. See, a pistol, kind of a welcome aboard gift. A lot of room for advancement, too. So long, Chief. No need for sad goodbyes. I'm sure I'll be seeing you around. It's a small town for you.
Act 3, Scene 2. At center stage is a small desk and chair, on top of which is a typewriter. Doremus sits at the desk.
This is a state of emergency. Please return to your homes. We repeat, a state of emergency. Those who are found in public without proper credentials will be subject to arrest.
Searchlights scour the stage. Doremus sits and takes a blank white paper from beside his typewriter, puts it in, stares at the paper. As he does so, we hear, coming through the radio,
"My fellow countrymen, as of 9:25 this evening, I have declared a state of martial law. The proclamation of martial law is not a military takeover. It is a power embedded in the Constitution to protect our republic whenever confronted by the danger of a violent overthrow. Such a danger now confronts us. New information out of Mexico and from within our own country bears proof of seditious activities that we must move to crush. By implementing martial law, we take all necessary steps to protect our streets and every citizen of this great nation."
Mr. President, as I sit and I write this, a darkness like no other descends on my hometown. The air, once light with promise, is now thick with fear. The currency of grace that once moved freely from the daily discourse of our citizenry has evaporated, replaced by an acrimony so vicious as to destroy our very humanity. There is no peace to soothe our suffering, no trust to restore our faith, no empathy to inspire generosity. There is only the disease of despair and the dull ache of survival. We lie in our beds at night, Mr. President, afraid to sleep, afraid of what our dreams of tomorrow will bring. And you, sir, are to blame for this. You and your ever-growing legion of Minutemen, those mercenary pirates who stand ready for your every new command to terrorize us. They roam the streets like drunken bullies, happy to intimidate anyone unlucky enough to cross their path, and hungry to beat up anyone who objects. The possibility of murder makes them giddy, and they yearn for the day when that final atrocity becomes legal. They are your henchmen, your hounds, and you bear full responsibility for every action they take and every crime that they commit. I myself have waited for too long to speak out publicly against your assault on our democracy, whether it be from comfort or apathy or pure cowardice, whether my vision was compromised by class allegiance or by intellectual rigidity, I could not see that, in fact, what was happening. Like some poor penitent, I kept waiting for some miracle that might restore us to sanity. But as the days have gone by and the memory of our past history, of America's
democratic legacy of civility, compromise, and respect for the fundamental right of every person has, like my hometown, receded into darkness. I reject you as my president, Mr. Windrip. I reject you as the man who represents the United States of America. May God look after your soul.
Good God in heaven.
Here.
Dad?
As your lawyer, I strongly advise you not to print this.
What will become of us?
Go ahead, Pop, print it.
Fowler!
They can't touch him.
Wake up, Fowler.
He's too strong in Beulah Valley for them to dare lift a hand against him.
You realize that under the new laws, sedition, you'll be incarcerated.
You know they'll come for you.
Is it too late to stop him?
I think it'd be criminal if somebody didn't try to stop these fellows.
You asking my opinion?
If you're asking me to vote, I'd have to say
yes.
I'd have to say yes.
No.
No, I don't think so, no.
Absolutely not.
You have to run it, yes.
Only you know, Dad. Only you know what to do.
Doremus Jessup, editor of the Daily Informer.
Act 3, Scene 3, newspaper office.
Doremus Jessup stood at the window the morning his editorial appeared, looking down at the gathering mob.
Get out of here! Let me go!
You deserve lynching, but we got worse.
Lights bumped to Doremus in a jail cell, alone, worse for wear, but not yet bowed.
It was before 9 in the morning when Doremus reached his cell,
which had a cot with a damp straw mattress.
A stool.
A wash basin with one tap for cold water.
Two hooks for clothes.
And a small barred window.
He remained there.
Without food.
With only tap water caught in his double palm.
Day passed into night.
He stared.
He tried to sleep but couldn't.
Until finally the dawn came.
Next case, D. Jessup, editor-in-chief of the Daily Informer.
A courtroom. Doremus is dragged in. On the judge's bench sits Chadledieu and another man, tall and handsome.
Military Judge Effingham Swan. Sorry to have to trouble you. Just a routine query. Do sit down. Close the doors. Mr. Doremus.
Jessup. My name is Jessup. Doremus is my first name.
Ah, very New England. But one's memory is so wretched. I'll just call you Doremus. Sans the mister. Now, Doremus, I asked my friends in the Minutemen to invite you here. I do trust they were not too importunate.
Oh, they were all kinds of what you would call importunate.
My deepest apologies. But I was in a rush, you see. I need your advice as a journalist. Now, does it seem to you that most of the people are coming to their senses and ready to accept the new order of things?
I thought I was dragged here because of an editorial I wrote about Windrip.
Oh, was that you? You see, one does have such a wretched memory. Yes, yes, I do seem to remember some minor incident of that sort mentioned in the agenda.
What are the charges against you?
Just trifling things. Criminal libel and high treason and homicidal incitement to violence, you know, the usual boring things, and all easily gotten rid of if you could just give us a list. A list of every person in this vicinity that you know of who is opposed to the administration.
You are not serious.
But I assure you I am.
I insist on having my lawyer.
You don't understand, my dear Doremus. Habeas corpus, due process. They've been suspended, only temporarily, of course, but just for the current crisis. And this unfortunate necessity of martial law is just something we'll have to navigate.
Damn it, Swan, that is a bald lie.
My commander, my dear fellow commander.
You know well and good it isn't temporary. This is permanent.
May I be frank with you, Doremus? I already have all I need, both in the reports of Captain Ledoux and the actual text of your editorial, to take you out and shoot you. I assure you,
what?
I assure you.
What?
I am quite empowered to do so. But one is really too merciful, so perhaps we can find a better use for you than as fertilizer, don't you agree? You will be released on parole to assist a new editor for the Informer, who has been handpicked by the authorities, but who doubtless needs certain points of technical training. And next Monday, you will begin publishing articles that respect the ideals and intentions of this administration. You'll enjoy.
What the hell is going on here?
Who is our impetuous friend?
Doc Greenhill, Jessup's son-in-law.
A family gathering. Good-looking young man.
A couple days ago, I offered him to be in charge of the medical inspection of all the meth men in the country, and he refused.
Did he indeed?
Said you and me should be digging ditches in a labor camp.
He's a liar. I never mentioned you. I don't even know who you are.
My name is Commander Effingham Swan.
Well, Swan, that still doesn't enlighten me. I've never heard of you.
How did you get past the doctor?
They know me. I've treated most of your teenage thugs for various unmentionable diseases.
How very kind of you.
I'm here to warn you, two big goons, that if you
don't...
What
the hell did you call us?
Let him finish. I want to listen to this a little longer.
I've come here to tell you that I've had enough. Everybody's had enough. This man is one of the most honest and respected men in Beulah Valley. If you think your toy soldier uniform gives you some sort of dispensation from the law...
Thank you, Doctor. I think we've heard enough from the comrade, don't you, Commissioner? Take the bastard out and shoot him.
You can't. I told you, I'm quite empowered to do so.
Grab the son of a bitch, take him outside.
No! No, no, this is outrageous. This is... You cannot do this, sir. By any law that is under heaven, you have no right! This is the United States of America! Man, this is the United States of America!
Blackout. End of part one. Intermission. Part 2, Act 4, Scene 1. A dining room table. Emma is serving, trying to remain upbeat in the face of pervasive gloom. Mary is seated, stone silent, her focus singular and elsewhere. Sissy and Julian talk in the corner.
It happened so fast. Doremus! Sissy, come sit!
Unemployment was eliminated by rounding up every person without a job and placing them in labor camps.
How's school, Julian?
Huge state-run universities were opened, free of any taint of intellectualism.
He's not in school anymore, though.
Unfortunately, smaller colleges such as Princeton had to be closed.
Back here for good now, Mrs. Jessup.
Amherst is a goner.
Oh. And in one single day, all crime in America ended forever. Who wants gravy?
70,000 Minutemen, working with town and state police officers, arrested every known or suspected criminal in the country.
1 in 10 was shot immediately.
4 in 10 were given prison sentences.
3 in 10 were released as innocents.
And 2 in 10 were taken in by the Minutemen as inspectors.
Oh, Mary, you must take a little more of the nice chestnut dressing.
Mary Jessup Greenhill was punished by the seizing of all the property and money her late husband Fowler had
I'm
left her.
I'm not hungry. Lover.
Just try a little.
No, just a slow.
Damn it, Emma. She already said she wasn't hungry. I'm sorry.
Doremus was miserable from writing propaganda in support of the Windrup administration.
So what will you be doing, Julian?
I thought I'd marry Sissy as soon as I could get a job.
Oh, Mary.
If Shed the Dew doesn't get to her first, he's the battalion commander now, after all.
We have to work on your sense of humor, Julian. Yeah. I can't marry a man with a bad sense of humor.
Do you really think that now's the time to get married?
Hello, all. Oh, Philip. Oh, I'm so glad you came. I wasn't sure you were going to make it. Oh.
You knew he was coming?
I wasn't sure I could get away, Dad, but I decided I just had to see my favorite family. Mary, how are you? It's a crime when you didn't get property. We'll do everything we can to fix it.
How's Danny doing?
He misses his mother terribly, of course, but he's fine. His cousins treat him like a prince.
It should only be a few more months, just until our Mary gets her footing.
Well, thank you, Philip.
There's no rush. We love having you.
Come eat with us.
I'm afraid I can't, Mother. Duty still calls. Just wanted to drop by for a hug and have a quick word with Peter here.
All right, then. We'll leave you two boys, but only for 5 minutes. Do you hear? After that, we're going to storm right back in here and devour you.
Come on, everyone. Dessert in the kitchen.
How are you?
You know what the worst is, Philip? Every day there's some new thing that I think will be unbearable. And yet, week after week, I find myself getting old.
Is there anything I can do to help?
No, I wish there was.
I know you're still having some problems with the authorities.
So, has my disgust for these people made it back to you? At least I'm making headlines somewhere.
You've got to get a hold of yourself. You've got to find a way to move forward.
That's the problem, son. I don't seem to be able to conceive of the future anymore.
I know it's bleak right now, Dad, but there is a future for all of us. Hoover and Roosevelt put us into this mess, and now we have to dig ourselves out.
By using stormtroopers to watch our every move.
The Minutemen are temporarily necessary, and there have been some good things. The crime rate has plummeted, and the stock market is the highest it's been in over a decade.
At the cost of what?
It's the making of a new society. I hate to say it, but you can't make an omelet without breaking a few eggs.
Hell and damnation. If I ever hear that
you
phrase,
said it yourself. How many times did I sit in this very room and listen to you talk about how we've gone soft? Obsessed with our new refrigerators or our air conditioners or any newfangled gadget. We needed to remember what you used to call the sturdiness of our ancestors. To restore toughness. Real toughness.
There's a difference between toughness and brutality.
But brutality is the way of the world. Do you think the Russians or the Germans don't want us to be fair? We have enemies. Real enemies with real weapons. Who will hesitate to pull the trigger? Who will use every form of brutality they can devise to defeat us? I know you don't like Windrip, but at least he's fighting back.
You do realize you are defending the man who murdered your brother-in-law.
That was Swan, not Windrip.
Do you hear yourself, Philip?
Swan will be punished, I promise.
You sound like a Bolshevik apologist.
I'm a realist. Windrip and his crew are here to stay. The sooner you accept this, the easier it will be.
For whom?
You must listen to me, Dad. You must. Why do you suppose I came clear from Worcester to see you?
God only knows.
You're going to get into deeper trouble if you don't start supporting the government.
Ah, so here it is. The reason why you've traveled all the way from Worcester, it's not enough that I've been stripped away of any journalistic integrity, that I have to dictate vast amounts of drivel every day to some stooge in Windrip's administration. No, I need to embrace Windrip's theology as well.
You need to think of Mother and the girls instead of yourself.
What are you getting at?
Nothing. I'm worried about you and Mother and Sissy and everyone.
All of this sudden concern. What is my reputation not playing too well with your business associates? Is the embarrassment of being Doremus Jessup's son too much to bear? What are you getting?
A future.
Future?
I've been reproached in regard to an assistant military judgeship.
I see. Go to hell, Philip.
I'll let you tell Mother that I won't be able to protect you.
Everything all right? Emma, do you think that I'm selfish? Yes, I do.
Act 4, Scene 2.
So what's so urgent that you couldn't talk about it on the phone?
It's happening. This afternoon, they arrested the editor of the Rutland Herald.
Oh, that's impossible. I would have heard.
No publicity. I got it from an engineer I know who works at the Rutland Milk Train.
Have you seen the new order of regulation? Any person who discredits the state will be executed or interned. And they're targeting journalists.
But I'm cooperating with
So is the editor of the Rutland Herald.
No, you're over it.
We're not. You have to leave, Doremus.
Enter Emma and Mary.
What's going on?
You have to leave. All of you, right away.
Leave? For where?
Canada. You'll have to go by car. A week ago you could have flown, but they've stopped the flight.
This is insane.
What will drive you?
I've got a Canadian driver's license and a Quebec plate. It's snowing too hard for them to care about anyone on the road tonight.
Tonight? That's impossible.
We need more time. Give us till tomorrow, at least. I've got to go to the bank. I've got about 20,000.
If you wait until tomorrow, it could be too late.
Oh my God.
I've got 1,500 Canadian for you. I'll get the rest to you soon.
But I'm not guilty of anything. Well, why would I be running?
To save your life, my boy. Just your life.
Sissy and Julian, enter quickly.
We got her as fast as we could.
They're coming for your dad. No time to explain. You have to pack up and leave right away.
But what about the house? What about our things?
We can figure all that out later.
Okay. When
you're safe.
It's okay. It'll be okay.
Come. We have to pack.
I'll help you. I'll help you, Mrs. Jessup.
I'm not going. I can't. Not without my son.
It's not safe to bring him right now.
I'm not leaving.
Mary, listen to me. Philip and his family are going to take good care of David. I'll bring him to you as soon as humanly possible when the danger isn't so great. I promise. I promise.
I'll go pack.
I'll get the truck.
In Canada, you'll have time to catch your breath. Join Trowbridge.
Right as soon as we get settled somewhere.
It may not be safe.
Well, how will I contact you then?
I'll find a way.
Act 4, scene 3. Lights up on 3 rows of chairs, 3 rows across. Buck's truck. The family piles a layer of suitcases onto the second row and a bigger stack onto the third row. In the first row sits Doremus, Sissy, and Buck, the driver. In the second row, sitting on top of some suitcases, are Mary and Emma. The car engine revs, Buck drives, no one speaks. Then,
would anyone like some coconut layer cake?
We're fleeing for our lives and you got coconut layer cake?
We're running all over the world. I thought we might want something sweet.
We're only going to Canada, Emma. You all right back there, Mary?
She's all right, aren't you?
No reply. Emma reaches over to squeeze Mary's arm. Silence. Passage of time. Lights change.
What trucks had heat in them?
Hey, we're lucky. Snow's keeping the temperature up. You should be in this thing when it gets really cold.
We should be thankful we even have a truck. It would be easier to be thankful if I could feel my feet.
Can you see anything through that windshield?
Enough.
Well, if I can't see anything, how can you?
Well, you're probably on about it doesn't help.
Are you scared?
Isn't everybody?
Silence. Lights change again.
Border's right up ahead.
I can't believe no one stopped us.
Nope. We'll make it all right. We'll make it.
A searchlight scans the stage, cutting across them.
Blast it.
Buck slows to a stop. The group starts to panic.
I thought no one was supposed to be here.
What do we say?
Well, what's happening?
Oh, quiet. Let Buck do the talking.
Two uniformed Minutemen with flashlights approach the car. The first Minuteman looks in on Buck, the second on Doremus.
Destination, Montreal, where we live.
Buck hands him his papers.
Goddamn lousy weather to be driving. Oh, watch your tongue, sir. We've got women present.
You don't say.
How you doing, honey? Happy to get home?
Of course. What part of Montreal are you from?
Point St. Charles, near the river.
Is that right?
Guess you forgot where you live.
Hi.
You'll have to wait till the battalion leader comes back. When's that? Hard to say. Maybe noon, maybe evening. See, we can't do that. My mother's sick.
Another sick mom.
It's the truth.
As 5 this week.
That may be so, but you'll still have to wait to get across. New regulations.
But I've seen funny. You folks taking this back road when it's a perfectly good highway just not far from here. Isn't that right, Sam?
Listen, mister, if I was you, I'd go back to wherever the hell you came from.
Unless the girls want to come inside. Warm us up a bit. I'll flip you for the one up front.
How dare you?
Shut your damn mouth, Grandpa.
You get my point, mister. All right. We'll go back to East Berkshire.
Then take off, you've heard him. Get out of here!
He cocks the gun. Buck starts driving. They all exhale.
Oh my God. You remember the story I told you about John Brown?
You start out scared and end up with a gun in your hand? Except I thought it was just a story.
Late the next day, the would-be refugees arrived back in Fort Beulah.
We can try again tomorrow.
We are not doing that again. Come on, girls.
We can make another go of it, Linus. The family will come around.
No, it's too dangerous. We have to assume that we're being watched now, and I cannot put them at risk.
What other option is
there? We stay. We bide our time, and I've got to save an alternate plan.
Well, think fast, will you? The wolves are at the gate.
Across the border in Canada, a group of expatriates were being recruited into a small army. Teachers and dock workers. Nurses and lawyers.
Farmhands and factory workers.
We're coming together as secret agents of the new underground.
Taking on disguises, they altered their identities as they prepared to take back their homeland.
My name is Dimmick. I'd like to discuss your life insurance policy.
Inside the White House, a small army of bodyguards stood outside the Oval Office.
President Windrip's legendarily short speeches were now reduced to a single word.
No. 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 No.
Yet taken to carrying his own personal firearm. For as much as he loved the people, he feared and detested actual persons.
It was astonishing how many people were being arrested. There simply wasn't enough room for the new flood of criminals. And so concentration camps were opened. Trianon, the girls' preparatory school just outside of Fort Beulah, was easily converted to this new usage.
Journalists continued to be targeted as enemies of the state.
And Doremus Jessup decided to get out of the direct line of fire.
Where do you think you're going? I didn't give you permission to leave.
I'm retiring, effective immediately.
Get back to work, Jessup. I'm enjoying the view too much, watching you lick Buzz Windrip's boots.
Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you, Shad, but it's well within my rights to retire. Time to enjoy the good life in President Windrip's America.
Still full of yourself, aren't you, Jessup?
And have it from bygone days.
Tell you what. You put a good word in with me with Miss Sissy, and I'll let you walk. She's special, after all.
Stay away from my daughter.
You don't want to play ball with me? Fine. It's yours. Now get back to work before you find yourself in trouble.
Oh, your superiors don't agree, Commissioner. They've approved my retirement.
We'll see about this. We're not through just yet.
Shad storms off as Pascal and Polycock enter.
Doremus' retirement wasn't retirement at all. He was desperate to fight against Windrip, and he went to see if he could work with the Democratic Socialists and the Communists.
You act like this is the first time anything like this has ever happened.
That's the thing about you, Mr. Jessup. Your capacity to be surprised.
I've never faced these conditions before.
No, just the preconditions. Remember during the last war when they renamed sauerkraut Liberty Cabbage?
Or in Florida, Oklahoma, and Tennessee outlawed the teaching of evolution?
Yes, yes, of course. We've battled hysteria before, but we've always righted the ship. We've always come back to some semblance of reason and order. And Trowbridge is our best hope of finding a way to do that.
Walter Trowbridge is a social reformer who is doing the work of the capitalists.
Oh, how can you be opposed to social reform, Pascal? That is the bedrock of political progress.
Tell that to the sharecroppers and the migrant workers.
So you pass some laws. You establish the right to create unions.
Well, the unemployment line keeps growing. The system's broken. Capitalism trumps democracy. When are you going to see that? Social reform is another way of doling out breadcrumbs to keep the system going.
Listen, Mr. Chesley, there's a part of me that wants to believe in Trowbridge myself. He's out there in Canada putting something together that feels honest and decent. But you gotta look at his political pedigree. Who really got Walter Trowbridge into the Senate? Big business. Big money. And these guys don't care who's in office, or the name of the party, or even the name of the country, as long as they control the ship. You don't think they'll come calling if old Walter ever makes it back stateside? Hell, they're probably funding his rebellion while propping up Windrip's fascist state at the same time. Carl's right. We need a new system.
A new system with new laws. A new state which will make promises and provide a brand new solution. The only problem is that there is no solution. There will never be a society that is anything close to perfect because there will always be men who prey on others, who seek enormous power, and who want to control our destiny, whether they're called kings, or comrades, or patriots, or little brothers of the poor. So the sooner we discard this idea of solutions, the sooner we can get to work with the messy work of democracy and staying true to our values and to our rights.
Not giving up on you, Mr. Jessup. You watch. At some point, you're going to join us.
They shake his hand.
Good luck, Mr. Jessup. Take care.
They leave, and as they do, starting to sound like an apologist for Trowbridge, John.
Just shut it, Carl.
And they're gone. Dimmick enters quickly from the opposite side, surprising Doremus.
Mr. Jessup!
I don't know your name, sir, but
How do you know that you've been spying on me all week?
My name is Dimmick. I'm here to sell you some life insurance.
You've been stalking me?
Isn't much time, so listen closely. I represent Walter Trowbridge and the New Underground. We have four divisions. Printing propaganda, distributing it, exchanging suppressed news stories, and smuggling suspects into Mexico and Canada. You've been identified as someone who can work with us. As you don't know me, you will suspect that I work for the Minutemen. Look over these credentials and call the person listed here, who I believe is someone you know and trust. He's one of us. And for God's sake, be careful. Assume the phone is tapped. Ask him if my insurance offer is legit. He'll give you his opinion. If you choose to join us, tell him you want to buy a policy. Are we clear?
I always assumed that I was a little underinsured.
Good luck.
Doritas bought the policy. He had no skills as a spy, and the danger would be great. But he would be working the grand American tradition of writing seditious propaganda.
Lorinda and Buck enter and assemble a small printing press upstage. Mary enters holding a large coat. We only see the inside lining. She sits and finishes sewing a pocket. From the other side of the stage, Sissy enters.
More than one Jessup was up to a little high treason. Mary threw herself into the work of a courier, taking her favorite gift from Fowler, a mink overcoat, and lining it with pockets that could hide secret pendants.
While Sissy went about trying to win the confidence of Shad Ledoux, she found him one evening outside Billy's bar, a favorite among the Minutemen.
A group of Minutemen and Shad appear, beers in hand. Sissy enters. Shad goes to her.
Miss Sissy, what are you doing here?
Looking for you, Shad.
You lost part.
They leave. He turns to Sissy.
I don't recall you ever glancing my direction much.
Things change. You know that better than anyone.
True enough.
I have to say I'm impressed. Dad used to talk like you were barely human, something Darwin conjured up.
I always figured that much. That Darwin's a mean son of a bitch.
Too true, Shad. But that's all in the past. Even Dad has to respect you now. The way you've taken over. I've been watching. No one messes with Shad the Duke.
You got that right.
I want to be on the right side of this thing, Shad.
How about you come over to my place and we get to know each other a little better?
Sounds like a swell idea. I want to hear about everything you're doing.
Buck Titus's basement became the headquarters for the Port Beulah cell of the New Underground.
The press was stolen, the type smuggled, and the paper shipped from Canada.
Within days, Vermont Vigilance,
a four-page weekly that usually had two pages and came out three times a week,
began to appear in the oddest places.
Doremus was back to being a real journalist, investigating leads and digging for the truth.
Dad, listen. I've been getting chummy with Shad.
Chummy?
He's sweet on me, and I've sort of been letting him, you know...
Sweet? What?
Oh, don't bust your gullet, Dad. I know how to protect myself. So listen, he's boasting to me of how he and Frank Tesbro have jiggered the numbers on all the new construction going on. And he keeps the records in a little red book right there in his house.
You did not.
I did. Photographed the book he keeps.
Do you know what he'll do if he finds out?
Yeah. The little red book is already back in its place, safe.
You think that you're going to get away with this?
Well, I already did.
If you think that you can control Shad Ledoux, you're mistaken.
I have the photographs. I'm done with Shad. There's nothing to worry about.
Until he flies into a violent rage when you reject him. How do you think that he's going to react when you tell him that these chummy days are over?
I know how to control Shad. Do you want the photographs or not?
Sadly, yes, I do.
Sissy hands Doremus the envelope. He takes it. Mary stands, puts on the coat, a full-length mink coat with special pockets now sewn into it. Sissy exits. Lorinda enters, hands Mary some pamphlets.
Here it is, the latest issue.
Mary takes them, stuffs them in the coat.
Please, be careful, Mary.
What can they do to me that they haven't already?
Mary exits. Doremus hands the photographs to Lorinda. She takes them.
Photographs of Shad's crooked ledgers.
Sissy?
She says that it's enough to put him in jail.
Girl is fearless.
And reckless, too.
I love her. Oh, you too. I love you too. It was the strangest thing.
The printing press is now operational. Lorinda, Doremus, and Buck print and stack pamphlets. Simultaneously, several 55-gallon drums are brought on stage surrounding the press. Minutemen enter with stacks of books and burn them in the steel drums.
Outside, the world continued to consume itself. But within the confines of Buck Titus's basement, there was complete freedom.
It was all happening so fast.
Julian enters in a Minuteman uniform.
Mr. Jessup? Sorry to interrupt, sir. I've only got a few minutes.
What is this, Julian?
And don't be alarmed, Mr. Jessup. This is the best way for me to fight them.
You're not equipped for this, son.
With all due respect, sir, I'm not sure if any of us are. Does Sissy know about this?
We've both had the idea. I think she's jealous of me going undercover.
That sounds like her.
I've got to get back. Lots of books to burn tonight. I'll try to hide your Thomas Jefferson collection.
Julian exits.
I've been contacted by the New Underground. They're reassigning me to Beecher Falls, near the Canadian border. I have to leave.
Leave?
Tonight.
No.
Please, Doremus.
Tell them you can't go. So tell them you have obligations. And
I'm not going to lie.
Well, then tell them the truth. That we finally figured out a way to be together.
And I've loved it.
Then stay.
But it's come to an end. This time together, it was a gift, but it was never going to last. You know it, and I know it.
I hate your certainty. I hate it.
She hands him the manuscript.
Your expose of Swan, waiting for your final edit.
He takes it from her.
Hide it someplace safe. I'm serious. This manuscript could get you killed. Take your own advice, Doremus. Be careful, please.
Lorinda exits, spotlight alone on Doremus. The flames get bigger. Act 4, Scene 5. Doremus' study, night.
The New Underground sent out a warning from headquarters in Montreal about being caught distributing propaganda. Agents were disappearing.
The time is now 10 p.m. All unauthorized personnel need to stay inside their homes until 6 a.m. Those who are found in public without proper credentials will be subject to arrest.
The lights go out. Total darkness. There's the sound of rain, thunder. The only illumination during the following is intermittent flashes of lightning.
Are you awake, Remus? It's so dark. Turn on the lights.
I'll get them.
No.
Keep them off.
The sound of the door being broken in.
Was that thunder?
Stay in your room.
Footsteps are heard coming upstairs.
Someone's inside.
5 minutemen pour into Doremus' study. The lines come all at once.
Daddy, who is it?
You have no right.
Doremus is grabbed and held.
Stop it!
She grapples with the Minutemen, gets tossed to the floor beside
him. The stove! Get
Doremus
the stove!
Doremus is pulled away from Sissy.
Damn you!
He's silenced.
So it's the stove, is it? Like you said, Miss Sissy, no one messes with Chateau Ledoux. Jessup, you're under arrest.
A flash of lightning reveals a terrified Emma looking in at all.
Remus.
Lights up on Swan, sitting before the court, holding typed pages. Chateau Ledoux is beside him. Doremus stands before them, beaten, bent, and broken.
Doremus Jessup, do you plead guilty to seditious activities?
Absolutely not.
County Commissioner Ledoux, is it or is it not true that Doremus Jessup tried to persuade you to join a violent revolt against my person?
It's true.
You know it's not, Ledoux.
I think Commissioner Ledoux's testimony, plus this manuscript, which was found in the prisoner's home, is more than sufficient evidence to convince. The standard sentence for seditious activity of this sort is execution, but I believe this case calls for a show of lenience. After all, any publication with the lyrical title of The Notorious Crimes of Commander Effingham Swan should be duly celebrated. No, Jessup, I want you alive. It will provide me a measure of daily comfort to think of you in prison. So I hereby sentence you, Doremus Jessup, to be held in a concentration camp at the will of the court for a minimum of 25 years.
Blackout. Act 5, Scene 1. Trinon Concentration Camp. Doremus stands in a pool of light facing upstage. Neatly folded prison clothes lie on the floor. A guard holding a billy club stands beside him. A doctor with a stethoscope and clipboard stands downstage of them. Cloth.
All of them? Deep breath. Again. Keep your eyes wide open. Teeth. Any pain?
Money.
Can you work?
What?
Get your clothes on, Jessup. Hurry up! I said hurry up! That's as fast as you can go? The doctor asked you a question. Do you remember the question? I said, do you remember the question?
Yes.
Can you work?
Yes, yes, yes!
Approved.
Pascal!
Mr. Jessup! Finally come to join the proletariat, I see.
Just in time, too. Carl can talk you to death instead of me.
What happened to your head?
A gift from the Minutemen. They accused me of being a communist. Can you believe that?
Big Mouth here decides to school the Minutemen on the difference between socialism and communism.
For which they decide to make me a member of the London proletariat.
Told you it was all going to go to hell, didn't I?
You did, Pascal. I just didn't realize that you were speaking literally.
Welcome, Mr. Jessup. Welcome to hell.
The lineup.
Fuck.
Fancy meeting you here.
What happened?
Ledoux and his boys found out I was stitching around town looking for parts of the printing press. Came in and busted up the place.
Well, how are you holding up?
Better than the printing press.
You guys shut up. You're going to get us all killed.
The yard.
Okay, we've frozen the bank accounts of every man in here, and I'm sure that Emma needs some money.
Windrip's supposedly getting more paranoid by the day.
I could have used those $5,000 that he promised.
He saw his guards laughing, thought the joke was on him, so he got his pistol out of his desk, started shooting at them. He can't last much longer.
We thought that he'd never get elected.
The cells.
How you doing there, John?
Never been better.
Hang in there, man. We got a lot of work to do when we get out of this place.
You got eyes on busting out of this place, Pascal.
Gotta be a way. Half the guards are on the take.
You really think that you can buy your way out?
There's always a way, Mr. Jessup. After all, this is America.
The yard.
Are you dizzy? Sit down, John. Catch your breath.
Oh my God. Oh, Julian. Mr. Jessup.
Hey, you need to see a doctor. Hey, guard?
No. Don't call them in, or we make it worse.
Somebody rat you out?
Chad Ledoux, they tried to make an example of me. I was copying names of people that were going to arrest.
What's Sissy involved?
Her name's not on anything.
Julian, I need to ask you. The rest of my family.
I looked in on Mrs. Jessup a few weeks ago, and she seems to be holding up. Mary's moved out of the house, and Sissy was talking about heading to Beecher Falls to work for Mrs. Pike. But no one's hurt. We're all safe.
Thank God.
Work detail.
John! John, talk to me! We're losing him!
Guard.
Talk to me! John! Hold on, brother!
Guard, we got a man down!
He's gone, Carl.
Stay with me, John, stay with me!
The cell.
Well.
How the mighty have fallen.
Nice to have you with us, Shad.
The man responsible for half of us being here.
That's why they're keeping him away from us.
Looks like he's half dead already.
They can't protect him. As soon as we hit the yard, we jump.
Pascal, stop. All of you.
Come on, Jessup. You're such a bourgeois pacifist after all you've been through.
We kill him, Pascal. We become just like him.
There's no part of that pig's life worth saving.
You don't think that I want revenge. You don't think that I don't want to tear his bones right out of his body, but he's still a human being.
The hell he is! Gave up his rights as a human being a long time ago. It's a call for the yard. Let's go.
I can't be part of this.
No one's asking you to do anything, Mr. Jessup.
Act 5, Scene 2. A police station.
I need to see Commander Swan. It's a matter of great urgency.
Your business?
I have information of seditious activity.
And what might that be?
I'm afraid I'll have to speak with him directly.
The commander's not in. You'll have to
see Sergeant, please. This information is of a highly sensitive nature that only he can hear it directly from me. It relates specifically to his well-being.
Lady, I don't care how urgent your business is.
My
but
well-being,
I'm sorry.
Is it? I'm flattered that my safety is of such concern to you, Mrs.
Fowler.
Thank God.
Please remove your coat, Mrs. Fowler. Please.
Oh, of course.
Coat's clean.
And if you would be so kind to let us conduct a gentle search of your person, I'm sure you'll understand.
Oh, but sir, I must protest. This is offensive.
Please.
Arms up.
Sergeant, would you give us a minute, please? Now then, Mrs. Fowler, your concern for my safety.
I overheard two men discussing you, Commander, saying terrible things.
These are turbulent times, Mrs. Fowler.
Mary.
Mary. What exactly were they saying, these men?
One of them said...
Go on.
I'm ashamed to repeat it.
Believe me, Mary, I've heard the most outrageous slander against my good name. Nothing you can say could possibly disturb me.
Well, sir, they said that you had wasted the privilege of your education at Harvard and Oxford, that you had used your training as a lawyer and then as an investment banker only for the purpose of attaining power and subjugating men to your will, and that all of your Bostonian manners were, what did they call it, a well-oiled facade to cover your nefarious intentions.
My nefarious intentions.
And they called you a murderer, sir, of innocent people.
Indeed.
I defended you, sir, I did, but... But they laughed at me and they called me horrible names.
And the names of these men?
They were planning to kill you, I'm certain. Wouldn't it be awful if somebody took a shot at Swan? They said, might change history. Their laughter was disgusting. And when I redoubled my efforts on your behalf, one of them spat at me.
There, there.
It's just too horrible.
Let's get the names. We will deal with these people, Mary. I assure you.
She takes a hatpin from her hair.
Ah! Jessup! That's the name! Mary Jessup Greenhill.
The sergeant re-enters and shoots Mary dead. Act 5, Scene 3. Three scenes with some overlap. Lorinda, Sissy, Buzz, and Doremus in China concentration camp.
It was happening so fast.
Sissy!
The information came in different ways.
Windrip's been deposed! All hell's broken loose in Washington.
Apparently, Buzz Windrip's right-hand man had gotten tired of being an appendage.
And had been working behind Buzz's back to put himself in office.
He had placed Buzz under house arrest and made plans for his deportation.
President Windrip did not take the news well.
You can't do that to me!
But Citizen Windrip was placed on a destroyer and 10 days later reluctantly arrived in Paris.
It's not so bad once you get used to the lousy cigarettes and stories of good flapjacks. Part of vous français. But I don't know, you know, I did okay. I managed to sock away 4 million smackers in some bank in a country I don't even know the name of. So, you know, life's not biting me too bad. Hey, how you doing, fella? Yeah! And so Buzz Windrip passed into history.
Taking with him his bad French accent and his millions of dollars.
But he left his iron fist.
And his successor freely used.
To smash all enemies of the state.
And so there was no liberation.
No deliverance from the suffering of the past.
There was only the thought of escaping the present.
Jessup, into the hallway, now!
I've paid off someone at Triana. Just bring your father. With any luck, he might make it out.
Third alley on the right. Look for the same. Wait.
They don't put schedules for prison breaks, Sissy.
Now.
How did you do it? How did you make contact with the guard?
Perseverance.
How did you tell me?
Why would I do that?
Because he's my father. Because I can help.
Unnecessary.
Because we should be working together.
Too dangerous.
Just like my father, stop protecting me. What else?
What else what?
Is Bach still at Tremont?
They moved him. Some place in Massachusetts. I'm trying to find out where.
And Julian. Julian.
He's alive. But they beat him up pretty badly. They don't like it when someone infiltrates their ranks.
Thank you for telling me.
He's a tough one, Julian.
Only 1 month after Buzz Windrip was sent back into France, the man who deposed him was himself deposed. The military had decided to eliminate the middleman known as the president.
Stormtroopers marched directly into the White House, putting a bullet through the head of every resident. 3 hours later, the military coup was declared a resounding success. The last vestige of democracy had vanished.
But the machinery of the state rolled on, regardless of who was in charge.
In the blink of an eye, everything changed again.
Philip enters on the other side of the stage, wearing an overcoat and carrying a cardboard box with some family heirlooms inside. On the other side of the stage, Doremus continues to embrace his friends.
Is he all packed?
I just need his passport.
Mother?
And everything's arranged?
Mother, it's time to go.
Have you got everything?
Here it is.
I'm sorry, Philip.
It's all right. When you've lived in a house for 40 years, it's hard to leave.
It's so strange seeing it empty.
So strange. I just got here and I'm leaving.
Are you ready?
Can we get across this
river? Are you ready?
I think so.
I think so.
Yes.
Emma leaves with Philip. Doremus exits, followed by Lorinda and Sissy. The narrators come on stage.
The military quickly established authoritarian rule, which was welcomed by many Americans.
People simply didn't have the capacity to think about anything that was overly complicated.
Most people were so consumed with trying to survive that complicated thinking of any kind was too much to bear.
And truth be told, they lost that ability years ago.
For, in a country that had praised itself so widely for free public education, there had been very little actual education.
There had been plenty of schoolrooms, but not enough literate teachers or eager pupils.
Not enough school boards who regarded teaching as a profession worthy of as much pay as waiting on tables or selling insurance.
Many Americans had been taught that God had selected them to supplant the Jews as the chosen people, the proof of which lay in the fact that America was the richest, the kindest, and the cleverest nation on earth.
They'd also been taught that economic depressions were merely passing headaches.
The labor unions were anti-American, and they must either be eliminated or made powerless.
That politics was an activity so simple that any village clerk was quite sufficiently trained to do the job.
Most of all, they were taught to believe in the fantastical power of money.
So much so that it was widely accepted that if John D. Rockefeller, Henry Ford, or any other business magnate set his mind to it, he could become the most distinguished statesman in all the land.
These beliefs were held by many, many people.
But not everyone. A rebellion had been brewing since the early days of Buzz Windrip.
A rebellion that Doremus Jessup now actively joined.
From their headquarters in Canada.
And with Walter Trowbridge as their leader,
the new underground directed the counterinsurgency, establishing strongholds that now stretched from San Francisco to Detroit.
Doremus had found a safe home in Canada. But he wasn't satisfied. Every night he dreamed of being sent to the front lines.
Act 5, Scene 4, Montreal. An aide enters, as does another man facing upstage.
Mr. Jessup, Mr. Trowbridge is ready for you.
Good to meet you, Jessup. It's been, what, 5 months since you've been in Montreal?
6 months, sir.
Long enough to feel homesick, get over it, and feel homesick again.
I'm afraid that the Canadians are sick to death of us.
Refugee fatigue. It's a brutal fact that no man can endure another man's tragedy for very long.
Well, there's a limit on human sympathy, sir, and I think we have exceeded it.
I see you've applied to be a field agent.
And I've been turned down twice before.
It would not be beneficial for us to trade an effective propagandist for an ineffective field agent. But new circumstances may have thrown a different light on your application.
During the last week, there's been a major shift in the movement of government troops toward the south. They're clearly preparing to go to war with Mexico, which has had the effect of loosening security all across the Canadian border.
Tough to maintain a wall across 3,000 miles.
We've had an opportunity to move a new wave of agents into the U.S. with unusually low risk, but we have to move quickly.
You've heard the news about our insurgents.
Yeah, but we've reached a standstill. In the areas where we've had a history of radicalism, we've established ourselves with relative ease. But there are vast portions of the country where we've made virtually no headway.
Well, I know it's heresy, sir, but can I ask if you've considered abandoning those portions of the country?
Everything's under consideration. But as of this moment, we're committed to the reestablishment of the Commonwealth of the United States. The entire United States.
We need agents on the ground with sense as well as guts.
Well, I hope that I can ride a little bit of both.
Can you? This is a younger man's game, Jessup. At our age, the highlight of the day is an afternoon nap.
Well, 40 years of reporting, sir, has endowed me with great skill. I can nap almost anywhere. And I assure you that I can do this job.
You realize you'll be in the trenches. Political grunt work of the most tedious kind.
No, I have no illusions, sir. I will be talking to people who have been terrorized into silence and political complacency. I understand that.
Goes without saying, you'll be in great danger.
I accept that risk, sir.
Can I ask, Jessup, what made you volunteer for this assignment? You could stay here in relative security and still make a contribution. I can't imagine you're nursing some lifelong desire to see the backwoods of Minnesota.
To be honest, sir, I'm not entirely sure. I spent the lion's share of my life in the comfort of a circumscribed world, and that world has been destroyed. Or maybe I want to prove to myself that I'm more than the person who inhabited that life. We all seem to be carrying around an excess of anger and guilt and fear these days. So who can say? The simple answer is that the times demand it, and I demand something different of myself.
You are aboard to General Barnes in Minnesota. I'll give you a list of contacts and the lay of the land.
You leave from Central Station at 5 p.m. on the 27th. That's 3 days from now.
Good luck, Doremus. We will win this day.
Hopefully in our lifetime, sir.
Act 5, Scene 5. The sounds of a busy train station. Jessup is waiting with a suitcase.
His packing was done. In his single suitcase, he had only a few items of clothing.
And a copy of Spengler's Decline of the West.
He waited for the next train to Winnipeg.
Train whistle. Lorinda enters in disguise.
Excuse me, but aren't you... Oh my God! How on earth did you...
The new underground, they sent word you'd be here.
But I get on a train.
I know! That's why I had to come.
And this costume.
For the benefit of the Border Guards.
Well, I hope they are suitably impressed.
And in the short time they had, they spoke of everything except what could not be said.
And Emma, I don't know, not a word since she sold the house that she moved in with Philip. And I've tried, like, repeatedly.
I trust she's comfortable in what
she... Can you promise me something?
If I can.
Sissy.
I tell you I'll take care of her, but honestly, the reverse is more likely. She is your daughter in every way. You look so well. Are you happy?
Madame et Monsieur, embarquement immédiatement, quai 3 à Winnipeg.
He realized that she didn't even have his address, that no one who loved him would ever have a stable address for him again.
Mr. Dobbs? Mr. William Barton Dobbs?
Dobbs, right. Sorry, yes, that would be me.
Can I show you your room?
Yeah, it's very kind of you, thank you.
That was a very interesting meeting today.
Oh, how so?
Can't remember the last time people around here just sat around and chewed over an idea. Everyone's so busy screaming about their feelings, like their feelings are the be-all and end-all, some kind of barometer of the truth, you know? When you talk, like, about political theory and group action.
Taking action as an individual for the benefit of the group.
The balance of liberty and democracy, the social contract and such. It was like people really trying to remember how to use their brains again.
Do you think they got the message?
Well, it wasn't easy for most of them. A lot of them. But you let your brain go slack and it hurts when you get to using it again.
Maybe you can follow up.
I can't say I'm real comfortable.
Well, we're all out of our comfort zone, my friend. All we can do is try, right?
So what do you think the odds are, Mr. Dobbs?
Oh, that's a funny thing. When I sit by myself, I feel scared and not very hopeful. But when I get out there into the world and I talk with people and I get past my feelings, as you put it, I start to think it is possible. Not about you anymore. As you say, it's not about me.
Will you be all right in here, Mr. Dobbs?
Yeah. I don't want to leave you all alone with those feelings.
I'll be fine.
All right, then. Good night.
Doremus sits in a chair and writes some notes. At the same time, along with two men, Sissy pushes a very large object covered in a cloth to another spot. The two men leave. Sissy removes the cover off the object. It's a printing press. She works alone. Julian enters.
Hello, Sissy.
Julian, you're alive.
Appears so.
I knew you were. Come help me. We have so much to do.
I know.
She goes to work one side of the press. He goes to the other side. They work together. A sound marching in the distance, along with humming.
We just had a phone call. There's a posse of Minutemen sniffing around looking for you. Time to go.
Right. Which way?
Straight on through. You'll figure it out.
Right.
And so Doremus Jessup disappeared into history.
But the struggle went on.
Past the span of his life.
And the lives of his children.
And his children's children.
And history marched on.
And the struggle continues.
Straight on through to the present.
Are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
Sissy and Julian start to run the press. The lights go out. End of play.